高敏是换一个人，我会去同意。
Thank you, Ashraf, for your nice introduction. And I would like to thank my dear friend, Dr. Osama Shahad, for inviting me to present this talk. Actually, vitamin D is a big issue. Yeah, vitamin D now, I think it is a lot of books. So I'm trying to catch some important points regarding vitamin D, because now vitamin D now is included in every aspect of clinical practice. As you know, vitamin D is a fat soluble vitamin, but it now is considered as growth hormone. It is not actually a vitamin. Because vitamins are nutrients, cannot be created by the body, but vitamin D can be synthesized into our body through the ultraviolet light and transported to the blood and then activated and act on receptors also. So it is a growth hormone. Also, it is a mechanism of feedback regulation between plasma cancer and active vitamin D. Regarding the history of vitamin D in the 17th century, there is the clinical picture of rickets for the first time, and in the 20th century, the discovery of dual project of vitamin D, and in 1938, the Adolf Winter earned the Nobel Prize due to chemical identification and the chemical synthesis of vitamin D. And from that history, there's a lot of benefits of vitamin D, because the vitamin D receptors have been discovered and is present in a lot of target tissues. 90% of vitamin D is inside through the skin by ultraviolet exposure. This is the colicalciferol role of vitamin D3. And 10% only from food, an hemocalciferol or vitamin D2. And this is the dietary sources of vitamin D. Fatty fish like tuna and mackerel, and salmon fish, good liver oil, and foods only fortified with vitamin D, like some dairy products. A ultraviolet radiation penetrates the uncovered skin and converts 7-hydrocholesterol to bring vitamin D3. The season and time of the day, days of the day, cloud cover, and skin melanin content are among the factors affecting ultraviolet radiation exposure and vitamin D synthesis. Complete cloud can reduce ultraviolet energy by 50%. And the shape, including the severe pollution, reduces ultraviolet by 60%, severe pollution. And ultraviolet radiation does not penetrate glass. عشان كده أي حد قاعد جنب الإزاز المحروق هو ياخد فيتامين شمس ويتعرض للشمس نو. Ultraviolet rays does not penetrate the glass. طب ده برش زي عشان كده ما تبقاش مفيدة لو ما فيش دايركت اكسبوجر. Sunscreen also is a protection factor for vitamin D producing ultraviolet rays. So don't depend on the glass. Number two, don't take sunscreen before sun exposure. Approximately 5 to 30 minutes of sun exposure, and this is the optimal time between 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Not early morning, not late afternoon. It is very important. This is the proper timing for ultraviolet rays to increase the vitamin D synthesis from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. with a lot of exposure to the face, arms, legs, or back, without sunscreen at all. Ultraviolet radiation is a carcinogenic. Early morning or late afternoon is a carcinogenic and responsible for 1.5 million skin cancer all over the United States. This is the basic hijab culture in our Middle East area, so the prevalence of vitamin D deficiency is significantly high in our area, because this is a basic hijab culture prevents the sun prevents the sun exposure and decrease the vitamin D synthesis. This is the vitamin mechanism of the vitamin metabolism of vitamin D, 7-hydrocholecalciferol ultraviolet to cholecalciferol or vitamin D3. A diet is a source only of 10% vitamin D2, then to the liver to 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, and then to the kidney inactive form of 24-25 diagnosed with a cancer or the act of form 125 may increase the silent absorption of calcium and the role with increase in mineralization of bone and increase the absorption of calcium and phosphorus through the kidney. So vitamin, this is the vitamin D requirements. And this is a factor that affecting vitamin D. Vitamin D regulation, regulating the production, they are affected in the production of vitamin D, skin pigmentation, with a tube, with dressing the pool, with season, with aging, with sunscreen, with air pollution. It will affect the synthesis of vitamin D. And factors regulating the absorption, decrease absorption of vitamin D, like life with less fatty acids, bariatric surgery, malabsorption syndrome, celiac disease, chronic pericarditis, and cystic fibrosis. But what is the symptom? What are the symptoms of vitamin D deficiency? How do you have a vague? Well, then the problem here in diagnosis of vitamin D deficiency. Then the test is very expensive. Up to now, it's very expensive. So if the patient getting sick, sick, fatigue, painful bone and back, depressed mood, impaired wound healing, hair loss, muscle pain, we are facing a lot of patients complaining from these symptoms, and these symptoms could be related to vitamin D deficiency. If vitamin D deficiency continues for a long period, it can result in more and more obesity, diabetes, hypertension, depression, fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, osteoporosis, and so on. So it is when you start with the common symptoms, and if it's persistent, it will lead to more and more complications. Vitamin D beyond bone disease and kidney affected a lot of factors, neuromuscular stability, skeletal muscle power, cardiovascular, proteinuria, immune system, and malignancy, hematobiosis, diabetes, aging. There are a lot of this is a share of vitamin D. Vitamin D now, يعني يكون كل الديزيز فيتامين دي والحقيقه في a lot of people about the use of vitamin D in various diseases. Vitamin D and psychiatry. This is published in paper 2017. Vitamin D status may delay very important to rule in appropriate brain development and function, mainly in a specific period of life, especially prenatal and neonatal period. Also, regarding the relation to vitamin D and autism, there is a link between both. And giving the vitamin D supplements to mice during the pregnancy prevented autism rates. There's a very recent paper also in 2017. An increasing amount of evidence about the possibility of gestation and the early childhood vitamin D deficiency causes some causes of autism. Children who are liable to become autism have lower vitamin D deficiency at 3 months of gestation, at birth, and at the age of 8 compared to the unaffected siblings. So the patient, so the children with autism or liable to autism have vitamin D deficiency in comparison with normal children. Vitamin D dose is also used in these children when 300 unit per patient per day up to 5,000, and in the term of prevention, although this is a small study but showed that vitamin D supplementation during pregnancy and during infancy and early childhood significantly reduced the expected incidence of autism in mothers who have history of autistic child from 20% to 5% after prediction of vitamin D deficiency. What about the relation of vitamin D and the respiratory tract infection? Vitamin D supplementation can help to prevent acute respiratory tract infection, particularly among B12 deficiency in vitamin D. This resulted in the British Medical Journal 2017, a lot of big studies, about 25 clinical trials, and 11,000 participants, including 14 countries, and this is to prevent acute respiratory tract infection. Also, these trials had some conflicting results because some individual papers show that there is no affection of the respiratory tract infection. Also, vitamin D supplementation can lead to reduction and 20% reduction of participation experiencing at least one acute respiratory tract infection. And it will decrease in acute respiratory tract infection. So it is very important that also there is a relation between vitamin D and cold. We have from observation vitamin D is common in winter, in which the vitamin D synthesis is low. And when is there any relation between cold and vitamin D? Yes, vitamin D supplementation could protect against acute respiratory infection, including cold and the flu. And it will protect against respiratory infection by boosting the level of antimicrobial peptides in the lung. So cold and the flu are commonly similar than the aspirin, where the levels of vitamin D are at their lowest level. And also through this mechanism, vitamin D can protect against asthma attack. Vitamin D and mortality. They found in this study, published in 2018, concludes that people who have suffered from cardiovascular disease and have normal intake of vitamin D reduce the risk of mortality as a consequence of disease by 30% in cardiovascular disease. But this is a difficult recommendation to be taken. And also here, regarding vitamin D and the mortality, a recent systemic review and meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials found that vitamin D supplementation is associated with decreased all-cause mortality risk among critically ill patients. Why? What is the relation between vitamin D and the cardiovascular disease? All causes of vitamin D can lead to vitamin D deficiency, which will increase RAS system, increase inflammatory cytokines, vascular calcification, and increase in myocyte skeletal flux. All these factors can lead to hypertension, active ventricular hypertrophy, heart failure, and coronary artery disease. So, if you will correct vitamin D deficiency, sure, you will decrease the mortality from cardiovascular disease. And also, vitamin D3 could help to restore damage to the cardiovascular system caused by disease like hypertension and diabetes. If we look here to the relation between vitamin D and AF, it is very important relation. Here there is Bermuda Triangle. Bermuda Triangle is heart failure, atrial fibrillation, and vitamin D deficiency. If atrial fibrillation occurs in patient with heart failure, especially in the first 6 months, you must check for vitamin D deficiency, because vitamin D deficiency should be considered on those patients. And this is a fatal triangle: heart failure, atrial fibrillation, and vitamin D deficiency. Also, peripheral arterial disease and peripheral resistance in peripheral arteries increase 1.8 times in patients with vitamin D deficiency. Vitamin D and pregnancy. Vitamin D deficiency associated with a lot of complications: preeclampsia, insulin resistance, immune modulation, preterm delivery, low birth weight, increased risk of cesarean section. It is very important, so insufficient. According to this study in 2017, there currently is insufficient evidence to guide recommendation to use vitamin D supplement in pregnancy, in pregnancy with normal vitamin D. But in vitamin D deficiency, yes, you can get, but WHO doesn't advise. Hence, you want to take vitamin D supplements during pregnancy. And also here, there was a lack of evidence of benefit of vitamin D supplements for maternal health conditions related to pregnancy. And with this meta-analysis of 2 and 8 studies published in 2016, it was found that maternal vitamin D deficiency in pregnancy can increase the risk of preeclampsia. Also, in this meta-analysis, more than 3,300 papers published in 2013, British Medical Journal, low levels of vitamin D is significantly associated with new-onset hypertension and proteinuria in pregnancy. And in case controlled study, this patient diagnosed a gestational diabetes or impaired glucose tolerance, they found that the hydroxyvitamin D3 concentration and gestational diabetes and impaired glucose gestation will significantly lower than non-gestational diabetes control. Regarding the obesity, also, children with vitamin D deficiency are more liable to obesity because vitamin D appears to disrupt the formation of fat cells. And according to the Americans, they are taking a lot of vitamins in the prenatal period, but there are a lot of vitamins like folic acid, iron, calcium, and other nutritional needs. But most prenatal vitamins contain 400 international units vitamin D, but not to increase more and more. This is up to now not recommended to be taken routinely during pregnancy. Regarding the relation between vitamin D and the cancer, this is a very big study including 33,000 male and female participants with age between 40 and 69. Vitamin D levels vary depending on the time of the year. All of us know this, and if you take vitamin D assay in winter, it will be different from summer times. The researcher found that higher level of vitamin D was associated with lower relative risk of overall cancer in both male and female. Higher vitamin D are also associated with relative risk of liver cancer. If there is higher vitamin D, it will increase the liver cancer, and no association was found between vitamin D deficiency and the lung or prostatic cancer. Also, vitamin D may protect against the risk of colon, but there may be a ceiling effect above which there will be vitamin D toxicity. Regarding the musculoskeletal pain, chronic widespread pain is defined as pain persistent at least 3 months. If not treated, it will lead to fibromyalgia. Vitamin D on those patients will be very effective and will also decrease the depression and anxiety which accompany chronic widespread pain. So here, 3 months replacement treatment has provided reduction in musculoskeletal symptoms, level of depression, and increased quality of life in patients with non-specific widespread pain and vitamin D deficiency. So patients with fibromyalgia and widespread pain must be investigated in regard to vitamin D deficiency. This is the muscle weakness and the risk of falls in elderly patients. Proximal muscle weakness, chronic muscle aches, myopathy, increased falls, daily 700 to 800 international vitamin D deficient elderly reduce the incidence of falls. When also the correction of vitamin D deficiency can improve the sleep quality. Also, there is a correlation between vitamin D and type 2 diabetes, because vitamin D deficiency can lead to insulin resistance and also can affect the pathogenesis of type 1 diabetes also. So it is regarding the role of the vitamin D and inflammation and increased insulin resistance, it will lead to alteration in glucose homeostasis and the development of type 2. This is published in 2017. Also about the relation between vitamin D and osteoporosis. A storage level of vitamin D maintains bone strength and might help prevent an osteoporosis. There is a direct relation between osteoporosis and vitamin D. Regarding vitamin D and the autoimmune disease, if there is any relation, yes. The higher prevalence of vitamin D deficiency among autoimmune disease in comparison to the general population. So vitamin D was as a deficiency was associated with various autoimmune disease like systemic lupus erythematosus, type 1 diabetes, multiple sclerosis, and others. Also, in rheumatoid arthritis, but also there is also vitamin D deficiency. However, if you will give vitamin D late in the disease, can lead to resistance to vitamin D, so it is better to give vitamin D early in the autoimmune disease. Regarding the vitamin D and vitiligo, yes. And they found that there is important point if you use topical tacrolimus only as monotherapy, and the effect will be deficient if they will take the topical tacrolimus together with vitamin D. So vitamin D together with topical tacrolimus will lead to improvement more and more in the vitiligo. Also, there is a relation between vitamin D and the thyroid disease. All these papers in 2017 and 2018. So a lot of papers and a lot of disease. For diagnosis, yes, that the vitamin D deficiency is less than 10 microgram per liter, insufficiency between 10 and 20, between 20 and 30, this is healthy, and more than 30, this is optimal. But who should be screened for vitamin D? An elderly patient, patient with normal absorption, patient with osteoporosis, and chronic kidney disease, so CKD also. This is one of the patients must be screened for vitamin D. The abnormal limit of vitamin D also, this is a point of discussion, because there is what is known as vitamin D toxicity if the limit is more than 150. So you should avoid to reach with the level to 125 to 150 to avoid vitamin D toxicity. Vitamin D and the CKD, yes, individuals with CKD are at higher risk of vitamin D deficiency, which start in individual with chronic kidney disease stage 2, and it will in the adequate level in all stages of chronic kidney disease. Regarding patients with hemodialysis, we found that the patient had less sunlight exposure, and 84% of hemodialysis patients with vitamin D deficiency had inadequate sunlight exposure. And also the uremia itself belonged to the response of vitamin D to ultraviolet radiation. And the hyperpigmentation, which is one of the common cutaneous manifestations of uremia, also to an additional role in endogenous vitamin D senses. So hemodialysis patients are liable to vitamin D. Also, there is a nutritional factor because these patients, CKD, frequently have low food intake and impaired gastrointestinal absorption of vitamin D. Regarding patient vitamin D and peritoneal dialysis, they found that the serum level of vitamin D on peritoneal dialysis declined progressively with time because they found that vitamin D will present in the peritoneal effluent. So, with time, the vitamin D will be decreased more and more in patients on peritoneal dialysis. Regarding CKD and proteinuria, because the vitamin D binding protein is alpha globulin, it's one of the protein, and it carries about 85% of circulating vitamin D. So patients with proteinuria have liable to vitamin D deficiency. And also vitamin D reduces fibroblast activation and interstitial inflammation. Regarding also diabetes, as we know, diabetes is one of the most common causes of chronic kidney disease. And the vitamin D deficiency and diabetes share major attributable for both conditions. So vitamin D deficiency, diabetes, and chronic kidney disease can be associated. Also, a body mass index, because vitamin D deficiency may be concomitant risk factors for type 2 diabetes and also for obesity. So there is overlapping relationship of risk factors involving the CKD, diabetes, and vitamin D deficiency.
2 minutes.
Also, vitamin D will have the supporting evidence that vitamin D will affect the RAS system. When had about أصلا في بعض some patients with a normal blood pressure down during the summer but increase in winter, and this increase in winter could be in summer he can stop all antihypertensive medication, but in winter will be exposed to more increase in blood pressure. This could be related to activation of RAS system by vitamin D deficiency in winter months. I finished. Dr. Ashraf, there's an inverse correlation between vitamin D level and the parathyroid hormone. The prevalence of secondary parathyroidism, hyperparathyroidism, almost doubled when non-dialysis patients presented with vitamin D below 20 nanogram per milliliter. So, the PTH, see, reaching to the plateau level, vitamin D is greater than 30. Vitamin D, D2 or D3, a high annual vitamin D and a low produce similar, most of them, vitamin D2 and D3, lead to similar initial increments in serum hydroxy vitamin D. But with time, vitamin D3 lead to more sustained response reaching to threefold difference between both vitamin D3 and D2. This is because vitamin D3 might have higher affinity in both vitamin D receptors and the 25-hydroxylase. So in the long run, vitamin D3 is more better than vitamin D2. And last point, tomorrow, inshallah, we will make it the second day of November. This is the day, this is the day of vitamin D. Day of vitamin D, to recognize that vitamin D deficiency is a worldwide problem. It is a worldwide problem. One third of the world is deficient in vitamin D. So they booked this the second day of November as the World Day of Vitamin D Deficiency. In conclusion, and with vitamin D deficiency, it was a day of vitamin D deficiency, and the doctors are beginning to discover that vitamin D deficiency is a risk factor for many diseases, including heart disease and cancer, and also discovering that vitamin D deficiency may make some disease more severe, like respiratory disease and autoimmune disease, and also they are discovering that vitamin D can be an important piece in the treatment of some illness and disease, including multiple sclerosis, asthma, fibrosis, and many other diseases. Thank you.
Thank you for speaking to me.
Do you recommend
of 25 hydroxy vitamin D for all CTD patients with hyperphosphatemia, speaking